Hello, everybody. Master Sukuri coming to you from Tokyo, Japan. Mestre Vibes, episode 39. On today's podcast, I want to talk a little bit about something I've been really interested in. Recently, I've been listening to and watching a lot of podcasts in Portuguese, and I thought that today's episode would be interesting to share some of the points that I see and that I analyze in the Brazilian or Portuguese spoken, the arena of Capoeira. So, being conversationally fluent and academically proficient in Portuguese, I'm hoping that I can share some of the insights that you might not be able to understand or have access to because the lack of Portuguese ability, or you just don't even know what's out there. Since last week I was watching, there's a podcast called Vem Pra Roda, and it's on YouTube, and I watched about four or five podcasts, and most of them generally go about 40 minutes, and they invite different instructors and different people to talk about different topics within the Capoeira community, and I thought I would share some of those. Before I share some of these, I really find it interesting, as for a while I'd cut off myself from a lot of Brazilian Capoeira connections, mostly between 2005 and 2012. And the reason was because it was very difficult to deal with people in the Capoeira community who were Brazilian. So I want to talk a little bit about that and why I cut. And actually, the main reason is today I get a lot of questions from non-Brazilians complaining, criticizing, or saying those are barriers in working with Brazilian Capoeira people. But we need to put everything in perspective, and I'm hoping that a couple of things I talk about will be able to help you clarify it. Now, I'm only going to be able to talk from my own perspective and how I see things, so I can't really get into how other people see things. First thing I want to talk about is, which I think is going to be really important, is I'd like to share a little about little comparison and contrast between the American educational system and the Brazilian educational system. So I'm going to give you guys a quick overview, and when I finish, I'll talk to you a little bit about my personal experience, who I have worked within the Brazilian education system when I was back and forth in Brazil, being part of different, helping projects such as different like social projects. Now, it's really going to be a little bit challenging to explain this, but I'm just going to, I wrote something and I'll read from that. Comparing the quality of education between Brazil and the United States can be complex, as both countries have diverse educational system and face unique challenges. And very important to remember is that there's also a very different perspective of education depending on your socioeconomic background, okay? Here are some key points of comparison and contrast between primary and high school education in America and in Brazil. As an American, I'll talk about my experience too. So if we look at the structure and organization, the Brazilian education system consists of basically three main levels of education. Primary education, which we call ensino fundamental, secondary education, which we call ensino médio, and higher education. Primary education covers students from about 6 to 14 years old, while secondary education typically includes students from 15, 17, or 18. So we would say that the higher education starts to become like what we would call high school. And in the United States, of course, you know, we have 12 grades. So We have elementary school, which is kindergarten to sixth grade, middle school, sixth, seventh, eighth, and possibly ninth now. And then high school is 9, 10, 11, 12. And education is compulsory for students up to a certain age, depending on the state in the United States. But I'm going to focus more on my background because I know that each state might have a different system. So in Brazil, the Brazilian curriculum is set by the federal government, but can vary slightly from state to state. It includes core subjects such as Portuguese, mathematics, science, history, and so on. The United States, the U.S. curriculum is determined at the state and local levels. So depending on where you live, that can have a lot to do with the type of education you have, and leading to significant variations across the country. Common subjects include English, mathematics, science, and social studies. When it comes to funding schools in Brazil, public education in Brazil is funded by the federal, state, and municipal governments. There are significant disparities in funding between wealthier and poorer regions, which can really impact the quality of education. Now, in the United States, public education in the U.S. is primarily funded by the state and local taxes, leading to varying levels of funding and quality between schools and districts. Schools in affluent areas often have more resources. So, for example, for me growing up in the United States, coming from a very, very low-income area, the property taxes around the area that gave to the school were pretty small. So what we had, what you could compare, like, for example, somebody who grew up in like in the northern part of San Diego, like La Jolla, in a very affluent area, their schools were noticeably and effectively a lot better quality, and they had a lot more resources. Teacher quality is also very important. In Brazil, teacher salaries can be relatively low, especially in compared to world standards, which can affect the quality of educators in some areas. There's also a shortage of qualified teachers in remote or underserved regions. For example, the more you leave the center towards the periphery, you'll find that there's less and less qualified teachers, as teachers want to teach basically in the bigger cities, in the bigger pay, getting better pay, and what they feel is more quality education. While in the United States, teacher salaries, although they vary state to state and district to district, but are generally higher than in Brazil. I know a lot of people are always complaining about how little we pay teachers, but compared to what teachers get paid in comparison to the quality and standard of living, the United States still pays pretty well. And basically, if we look at the end, like so, at standardized testing, the Brazilian education uses standardized testing in assessment of student performance, such as the Sistema de Avaliação da Educação Básica, SAEB, and the Exame Nacional do Ensino Médio, the ENEM, for high school students. While in the United States, we rely a lot on the ACT or the SAT, and these are generally used for ways to check to see if people are going to be going on to college. And of course, each state also administers their own, like, standardized testing, so we can see each person's level. And as a result of this, in Brazil, people face a lot of challenges related to high dropout rates due to social economic reasons. Grade repetition is also really high in Brazil, and educational inequality. Access to quality education can really be different between urban and rural areas. The United States also deals with disparities in educational outcomes, it generally has higher levels of educational attainment and lower levels of dropout rates compared to Brazil. So in summary, Brazil and the United States both have strengths and weaknesses in their primary and educational school systems. Brazil struggles with issues of funding, equity, and educational inequality, while the United States faces challenges related to disparity in resources and outcomes across different regions. Improving education in both countries requires addressing these structural issues and investing in teacher training. Curriculum development and resources for the students in underserved communities. Okay, so I just wanted to tell you guys a little bit about the difference between American and Brazilian. Now I'm going to tell you how I see it and why it makes it difficult for people to understand how difficult it can be in dealing with people from Capoeira teachers from Brazilian backgrounds. And this is not a statement that all are like that, that everyone is like this, but I'm saying generally in connection to the educational background in Brazil, plus the research done in my second book, Capoeira Fire, where I've mentioned the thing that all the older Brazilian masters were complaining about younger Brazilian teachers is they lack education or social education. Social education is something I'm really going to be talking about today. So we've all heard the stories about how so-and-so, like, I guess it's kind of like the marketing or the commercial. Oh, this Brazilian master or this Brazilian capoeira person is so good at capoeira. And people get enamored with an image that they see from afar or at the roda, not aware of the person's sociocultural development. And I can't tell you how many millions of times I've heard people complain about how Brazilians behave, how Brazilians interact in a professional level, and how capoeira Brazilian teachers are doing. So this is not about being Brazilian, but how it is to come from that background and something that I understand because I come from a very similar one. So I'm not saying that criticizing Brazilian people for lack of education and social awareness, I'm going to try to explain where it comes from so you guys can have a better understanding of why things happen the way they do. So now let's look at Brazilian education. In the United States, basically going to school is a full-time profession. I'll start at high school because that's where the main divergence takes place. So the Brazilian standard education, if you go all the way through high school, is to be able for you to have the education level to, I can't remember who said it, but it was a politician in Brazil who had said, the education system is just so that you can run a register at the local supermarket. Another politician once said here in America that the high school education is so that you're able to work in a factory. And these systems are to create drones. I'm not talking about upper level education backgrounds such as private schools and whatnot, but standard public schools. And a lot of these, we say someone's like, for example, the biggest challenge that I think a lot of first world country people have, and this is why sometimes when I tell people, look, I did away with dealing with Brazilians for 7 years because it's so difficult. And the reason was is because they just didn't understand how to live, function, deal, flow, contribute, and navigate the waters of outside of their localized areas in Brazil. And one reason is if we compare education, well, for example, when I went to high school or junior high or elementary school, it was most of the day. While in Brazil, people tend to go only for a few hours, like 4 hours, either in the morning or in the afternoon. So the amount of education tends to be a lot less. Then, having lived in Korea, Japan, Brazil, all these different countries, there's also a level of social education. Now, what do I mean by social education? Social education is when you come to understand that you cannot, that you are part of society, but you are also, how can I say this? You're also looked at, and you have to create your position in that. If no one gave you the social education to understand that, if you come from a lack of education, a lack of understanding of what professionalism, a lack a lack of social consciousness, then you get what we have here. If I had to compare what generally Brazilian education is, I would compare it to not all across the board. Not there. I've worked with doctors, doctorates of cultural anthropology, of sociology, and from Brazil, and they're highly educated, but they do tend to come from better families and have had better access to education. And we forget that this education level and the social cultural education is also very lacking in Brazil. Growing up, and especially start to grow up in the capoeira world, you get told that it's about cutting corners. There's always a way. People are very unprofessional. And I work with a lot of Brazilians here too, who are musicians who have never been able to develop any higher level of trust or professional trust or professional stability, because they never understood what they were saying. And when I say things like that, I mean, like, for example, when I'm watching these podcasts or listening to these podcasts in Portuguese, as a cultural anthropologist, I'm checking, and there's just a lot of catchphrases, a lot of keywords that everyone uses. And I not saying they don't know, but as I listen to them speak, I don't feel that they understand what the terminology or what the expression or what they're really saying, if they really understand what they're saying. Words like marketing, business. Brazilian, in Portuguese, we say, do a good job, faz bom trabalho. But it has no connotation of professionalism. It just says, don't do something bad. So to do a bom trabalho, for me, I feel, does not mean to do a professional job. It just means don't do something bad. And an example of which would be like, show up late, do something illegal, steal, disrespect or tarnish your image in your professional career. And that's it. But it has no concept of professionality. So a lot of times when I talk with friends who are Brazilian, they're always like, Mestre Sucuri, how did you get to your level? How did you organize? I go, well, I had to learn to be professional in the capoeira world. And that's actually been a challenge, because when I started, I never thought of capoeira as a career. And it wasn't until I was about 25, 26 that it really started entering my head. And I really understood that I have to do this professionally. And it took many years to develop. So now I can say I'm a very professional capoeira teacher. And I think that when I say that, most people have an idea and they think, you know, oh, this is what it means, but they really lack the higher education to understand. And it's not about, I'm not trying to talk down, I'm trying to say, guys, there's a lot more out there. There's points you have to understand. There's points you have to build on so you can improve your life. So I came from a very, we say favelado, or very ghetto area. And I was programmed to think that way by my mother, by my peers. Hustle. Only if you get caught, it's illegal. You can always talk your way out of everything, manipulate people. And for me, this is actually a very good skill when I entered the capoeira world, because I was able to recognize it. And that led to a lot of problems, because people would be like, oh, well, why don't you want to work with this Brazilian master, or why don't you want to work with that Brazilian teacher? I say, or this musician, or that dancer. And I would say, because I don't want to. Because they can't be trusted. Oh, that's, you don't understand. They come from a very, I do understand. I understand better than most people. And because I understood, I had to cut off those relationships until I could get to a point where I could command my behavior and my professional career in the way I want to with the people I want to. Nothing is more important than your ability to create positive relationships, nourishing relationships around you. If you notice, like a lot of Capoeira people will tell me, especially if they've been around for a while, four or five Capoeira teachers will get together, and if they start to talk negative, they all go negative. But if you could get together with four or five Capoeira teachers and be positive, well, there's no limit to where you can go. But you have to have a basic socio-cultural education. In Portuguese, a lot of the masters were talking about educação. Like, a lot of the Brazilians don't have education. So what I'm saying now is not, I know, in first world countries, and people will start to go, oh, you shouldn't say that. That's kind of talking about another people, another whatever. I said, no, this is the topic that we talk about in Portuguese that I'm translating and letting you guys know so as it doesn't affect you in a negative way and you can learn from these experiences. So as we move forward at this, I feel it's incredibly important for people to understand, just because someone is fantastic at Capoeira does not mean they know what they're doing, they're educated enough to communicate that, or they've built any form of professional understanding. There are a lot of amazing Brazilian Capoeira teachers and masters, but I would have to say the majority tend to be from those backgrounds. And one of the podcasts, like this, everything I'm telling you guys right now are points I'm building on from these Portuguese, from Vem Pra Roda podcast points that I want to share with you guys. But these are the topics in Portuguese by Brazilian mestres, professores, contramestres, contramestres, and masters. So I'm sharing you guys the conversation from that level. This isn't something that I'm criticizing. This is something I'm sharing with you guys. So if I had to really think about how would I compare the average Capoeira teacher from Brazil, the average, I would have to say they are pretty much like the Capoeira, I'm sorry, think of a really good breakdancer or hip-hop dancer from Brooklyn, or like a really poor area or low-income area of New York or of L.A., just because they have a lot of skill and ability in something that has cultural value, something they can sell and get social status from, does not mean that they have the artistic or social education that needs to be grown with that. So, for example, a lot of times when I'm dealing with Brazilians, I have to really think, you know, like the Latinos and the African Americans that I grew up with in the United States, that I have to think about them in that way, which basically means no world social education, no positive social education, regardless of the reason where they grew up. For example, I always talk about Mestre Batata, my dear friend. He was a street kid. He was a street kid from when he was 7, 8 years old in Rio de Janeiro, back in the day. He grew out of it. He made good choices. And he even said, you know, he kind of hustled his way into better society. And he got married to a very intelligent and wonderful woman. And they built a life together. But he also recognized where he comes from and where he wanted to go and what needed to socially, educationally, and social education develop for him. Same as I did for myself. So sometimes we look at people coming from Brazil and we're like, we're mystified by their level of capoeira and how we see them as being so cool. But at the end of the day, they're still people. And if you're a capoeira teacher and trying to work professionally with Brazilians, I just want to say, you know, don't be shocked when it's difficult, when it's challenging. But don't, most important, don't look at yourself and say how you can be better, but don't expect you yourself to do everything. You've got to make sure you get good people, people who are growing, and people who are trying to do better in their lives. Guys, this is just some of the topics I saw this week, some points I wanted to pull out. There's a lot of good people doing good things in Brazil with capoeira. And the truth of the matter is, like, it's all about social consciousness, consciencias, sabedoria, wisdom, all these different things that we talk about in Portuguese. So here's a little reflections on some of my week. Guys, if you have any questions, please throw them out to me. Let me know what you think. I'm always interested. And have a fantastic day. Mestre Sucuri, Capoeira Zoador Tokyo, Mestre Vibes. Lots of love, lots of peace, lots of capoeira.